Good afternoon, all. Look, I'm presenting this paper this afternoon on behalf of the whole feral cat team that successfully took cats off Dirk Hartog Island in WA. We'd like to acknowledge the Gorgon Barrow Island Net Conservation Benefits Fund for funding the program. So in terms of Western Australia, there's been a succession of islands that have been treated and had feral cat populations removed, with Hermite, Foray, Rottnest, ultimately leading up to the eradication work on Hartog. Current time, there are no more islands with feral cat populations off the West Australian coast that we're aware of. And the scale up of these islands was important to achieve the grow the knowledge base in how feral cats work and perfect the tools for control, removal and monitoring. So talking about Hartog itself, 620 square kilometres, it's currently the largest land mass that a cat population has been removed of. It was situated within the Shark Bay World Heritage Area, approximately 80 kilometres north to south, 11 k's wide. Preceding our eradication works, the national park was declared over much of the island, leaving smaller portions of land for the former leaseholders, the pastoral family, so they're able to retain the footprint of their station as a tourism enterprise. Now, we're fortunate. And one of the key things that assisted, I think, that there's never been a history of foxes, black rats or rabbits established on the island. Certainly foxes and rabbits are abundant close by in adjoining parts of the Australian continent. We do know that feral cats became established early in the 19th century. With pastoralists or fishers or other folk having cats. And those cats themselves were implicated in the local extinction of multiple native species on the island. We also knew that if those native species were to be re-established on the island, the feral cats had to go. So the process undertook a significant preliminary period of work before the actual eradication plan took place. So there were several pilot studies during which removal techniques, be it baiting or trapping or other things, were trialled. Monitoring methods were trialled and developed in terms of the statistical techniques as well. And then other tools such as conservation detecting dogs were invited to come onto the program, and they were given the necessary lead-up time to ensure that their detector dogs were trained up when we needed them. And there was also a very strong surveillance phase in this program, as you expect in island restoration programs. So those pilot studies, for instance, looked at the efficacy of baiting operations, the bait density, and typically they involved, putting baits out labelled with rhodamine B, bait marker that many people are familiar with, and we were able to obtain ranging data on those cats and also look at, how cats used the landscape, what they ate, when they were going to be more likely to eat a bait than not. So there was several years of radio tracking studies or discrete studies, if you like, on the island. Picture down the bottom, I'm not sure if you can see my cursor, but that's a loggerhead turtle hatchling that the feral cats were swallowing whole. We also got some interesting information on cat diet along the way. So a critical part about Hartog, given the size, is that it was just too large for the field crew to manage the cat population, remove that population simultaneously. So a barrier fence was established in an east-west direction across the island, and a quick shot of it there. The soil, as you can see, is largely sand, but there are limestone outcrops through it. But that sand as well gave us a perfect surface for identifying cat prints as well. Getting to the actual eradication, the island was first eradicated in 2014. Once we're scaling up to eradication phase, so that was the primary management tool. Typically, baits are at 50 baits per square k on predetermined flight paths, and we've been able to measure the ground spread of those baits coming out of the aircraft at each group of 50. We're in approximately 200 by 40 metres. We had populations of collared cats within the area, so we were able to monitor the efficacy of the baiting as well. So that's our bait plan for what was delivered on ground for 2014. So essentially the whole island was baited, other than you can see up in this northwest corner there was an area that wasn't baited. There was insufficient baits in the aircraft to do that. And in 2015, just the northern area, northern management unit, which is kind of two-thirds of the island, was baited because we had previously cleared and confirmed that the south was clear of feral cats. So this is an interesting story about feral cats and baiting, really. 2014, we had 15 cats collared, and all 15 of those cats died as a result of bait consumption, indicated by the collar returns. So, best possible result. We had to remove another 7 feral cats with ground trapping or leg hole trapping. However, early 2015, we only had 5 cats collared, and only one of those baits killed the collared feral cat. The other 4 survived. And the interesting fact is, while it's the same dirt and same bait, in between those two baiting operations, we had a cyclone which likely dropped a lot of rain, which started the grass seeding, which started the response of the native prey resource, which meant that food wasn't a limiting factor to the same extent as it was the previous year. So baiting for feral cats can deliver variable results even on the same landmass. So leg hole trapping, that was the follow-up removal tool following the baiting operation. So basically once the baits had gone out, we'd done our follow-up monitoring, traps were in the ground and the traps kept working while the crews cycled on and off. Alongside that, we had a intensive monitoring program which was using both camera tools and just physical observation by the field crew driving on these management tracks that we'd created. Each operator operated one up on their own bike and was doing heaps of Ks, looking for field sign on track or in particular key areas with beaches or bird roosts and the like. Detecting cats, as I've just mentioned, was using those various tools. And we got an idea where cats are likely to be active rather than not. Moving to the verification phase, once we had established a long line of zeros in terms of detection of cats via trapping and cameras and field sign, we invited a consultant dog team to come in. So they travelled across from Tasmania with dogs that were already good on identifying and responding to cat scent in terms of scats and urine. In this case, we only expected them to indicate to cat scats because there was something visible for us to see. And they did 3 surveys on the island over the years. As a final desktop type review, we also presented all the monitoring data to Island Conservation, which is a internationally recognised restoration agency or philanthropic group, in the US that conducted a desktop review of our results and that provided some independence to the determinant of eradication. Where I'm up to. So, yeah, surveillance. You can see there was a lot, each little grey dot, there was a large and significant camera array. I think it was 130-odd cameras from memory now. They were, obviously screened regularly for cat thorn. That surveillance period went for 2 years, which we figured would have been more than sufficient for cats to show themselves had they been there. So eradication success. The eradication commenced in 2014. We think the population was around that 440 size. You never really know quite how many you take out with baiting because you don't always find them kind of thing, but baiting in the first year was as successful as you'd expect. Our last cat was trapped in October 2016, and it was very interesting and probably not surprising that the last few cats were detected with long distances between these observations, so in terms of time and physically, so the last few cats were ranging considerable ways. The last cat was an unmated female. The last male, if you like, second last cat on the island, exhibited a sort of unconcerning sort of behaviour where he was actively avoiding camera traps. So the footprints in the sand told the story that this cat was walking around the back of camera traps and rejoining the management line. So you don't want too many of those cats in these programs. We covered some enormous kilometres doing the trapping and monitoring programs. So and the cost of the operation overall was, as shown there, is about $4.5 million. I'm not sure how I'm going for time alone, but one of the critical lessons we saw, despite our predator-proof fence, we did have a fence breach by this particular cat. This was one of the animals collared in 2015, in the second year, and he crossed the fence twice while the collar was active and probably another two times after that, that he was, detected on camera, and I also saw a cat that was on the wrong side of the fence physically one morning. So this cat ranged up the whole 80 kilometres of the coast, if we were to zoom this picture out. If obviously looking for love, food wasn't a limiting factor, but, we caught up with him in the end. But, yes, we did have a fence breach. And that's it. Did that work?
Yeah, that's great. We even have time for one or two questions.
Oh, beauty. It all went silent there, so, yeah.
And I think one of the questions is one I had too, but someone else asked, so, and I think you did say it was eradicate bait, which is
correct.
Got 1080
yes.
in it?
Correct, yeah, so that's 4.5 milligrams 1080.
Yeah, and you didn't use PAP or a probate or anything, it was just eradicate?
No, eradicate only, yeah.
And then I have a follow-up question, which I can ask since I'm chair. You said there's no black rats, but are there Norway rats there?
No.
So rats at all, no Pacific rats or Norway rats?
No, so house mice certainly, and they, they certainly erupted after the... after the cyclone, as well as the native mice as well. No invasive rodents.
Did the mice eat the 1080 baits? Did you get any non-targets? I guess they wouldn't be non-targets. They'd be introduced mice. It'd be good if they died.
Yeah, no, we certainly didn't see that on the cameras. They would show up or would have shown up on the cameras because there was a bait in front of all the cameras in the second year. same with the dunnarts, little long-tailed dunnart. We didn't see any evidence of them interacting with baits either. So, yep.
Oh, well, that's great. Thank you very much, Michael. And that's just an amazing thing to have done, Dirk Hartog. It's such a big island.
Yeah, and I think the key thing now is there's another crew that are on the island doing the wildlife translocation. So, yeah, it's, you know, the value of that work is now being realised.